Hello and welcome to Walk the Talk. I am Shekhar Gupta in Delhi's very crowded Kalkaji in this tiny piece of green here. And my guest this week, somebody that all of India actually should be very proud of, but the cause that he's espoused all this while for more than three decades now and for which he's got the Nobel Peace Prize is something that should embarrass all of us Indians, isn't it?
Thank you.
So we are proud of you, but we are embarrassed about what you've been exposing.
It's not the matter of embarrassment because it's a global phenomena, it's a global problem, and it is not only the Indian systems and society and politics, economic, which is responsible. There are global reasons for it. So I'm fighting not only in India but against a human problem, global problem.
But you sometimes face this criticism that you are exposing all of India's warts to the whole world.
I have exposed the Americans, I have exposed the Pakistani, Chinese. Wherever I come to know about the existence of child slavery and child labor, I raised their voices. I raised in the United Nations, I raised in the ILO, I raised this voice everywhere wherever I could do. So sometimes some of my fellow countrymen might be seeing with the narrow Indian eyes in that sense, but I see that children are children wherever they are, if they are exploited, if they are deprived their childhood. If I can become their voice as a very humble, ordinary Indian, I would say, I would love and proud.
What's the best thing that's been said about you? And what's the worst thing that's been said about you?
Oh, the worst thing I could begin with. I can't recall the best thing. Perhaps you can say the best thing today.
I will.
But the worst thing was, he's a traitor, he's a Pakistani agent. And now the prize was jointly given to me and Malala. So it looks that I have some connection with Pakistan.
So you're a Western agent in both countries. Both of you are Western agents.
I am the children's agent. It could be the Western or Eastern.
I think the best thing said about you was not just the Nobel Prize citation. It was what Senator Tom Harkin said in U.S. Congress.
Yeah. I feel very humbled. He said that a new Gandhi is born for children and things like that, even more than that, which I don't want to repeat. But he had given a full big speech, I think back in 1990 or 91. Hmm.
Yeah. See, there's an issue, we'll talk about your work, but there's an issue here. Peace prizes that come to developing countries, my professor barred us from using third world. No third world, no superpower, he said it closes your mind, so I'm not saying third world. Peace prizes that come to poorer countries come for people who are working with extreme poverty issues there and are exposing them. If you look at India, see Mother Teresa. Is there a little bit of sort of poverty, pornography involved in this?
If it is the case, then one time my biggest competitor was President Obama. He was nominated and I was nominated and President Obama got the prize and it didn't.
Well, I can say emphatically that he got it undeservingly.
No, I won't say.
He got it.
He got it for making issues. But your argument that it is normally given to such issues may not be so correct.
No, but I'm talking of Nobel Peace Prize given in developing countries, poorer countries. Once again, I'm careful not to say third world.
Yeah, not really. Not really, not in developing countries. There are a few examples, but there are many more. Most examples come from the politicians from developed countries or former politicians who try to do something for peace. So sometimes many people feel that the peace is something which could be restored by the Western powers, the powerful people. Peace is something which could be imposed on poor nations by the developed countries. That could be the notion of many people. But the truth is that the peace will have to be established by the people, those who live in the abject poverty. Because poverty in itself is the biggest violence. Hmm.
And you haven't particularly come from a privileged background.
Not really. I come from very ordinary background. Though I was not extremely poor, my family, I mean. My father was, when I was born, he was a simple police constable. Very honest. But so that
which could either be a very poor in Indian or a very well-to-do Indian. A police constable could be anything.
Yeah. So constables are normally poor and they are always one or...
Honest constables.
Yeah. Many of them, or most of them, honest, because they cannot do it easily. In big cities and towns, it's possible that they can get money on the traffic lights.
But you come from Vidisha, which, as I noticed now, is Sushma Swaraj's constituency now for two elections.
That's great. Vidisha is the place of Samrat Ashok's in-laws.
Right.
And I am much more proud because two of his children, one son, Mahendra, and daughter, Sanghamitra, they were first Buddhist monks to cross India for peace and non-violence to Sri Lanka and then to Burma. Ashoka and Sanghamitra were among those.
Pardon me for reminding you, but you know, the president of Sri Lanka is named after that Mahinda. he makes a sort of an intriguing Buddhist. If you go back to the essential message of Kalinga.
Yeah.
But having said that, there's a peculiar challenge in India. I'm not taking a view yet on your work. The peculiar challenge is that when you expose our warts to us Indians, we react like the immune system in a body reacts to a foreign virus. Why are we so unwilling to look at what's wrong with us?
It's a mindset. For instance, there are many diseases, and still many diseases, that people try to hide. They say, oh, it's a part of life. If you keep on hiding the diseases, it is not going to solve the problem. It would be exaggerated and become unmanageable. I believe in truth. I believe in truth. Truth sometimes looks ugly. Truth sometimes looks very beautiful. But truth is truth. If the truth is
Truth never harms anybody.
Truth never harms
beautiful
anybody.
Beautiful or ugly.
Exactly. So if something is truth, we have to accept is that this is truth. And then we have to see that how we are going to make it better. How we can achieve the most beautiful side of that truth. If a child is deprived of childhood and freedom, and you keep on hiding, considering that, oh, he's a poor child and he's working, nothing is bad in it. Or if he's removed from there, he will die, starve, etc. This is not going to solve the problem. But this untruth has been sold in the name of truth for ages because of wasted interest.
But there is a livelihood aspect to child labor.
Look, Shekharji, globally, 168 million children are in full-time jobs, according to government.
16.8 crores.
Yeah, 16.8 crores. And 20 crore adults are jobless. And there are ample of studies which prove that most of these jobless adults are none, but the very parents or elder brothers and sisters of these children. Look at the vicious circle.
But is there empirical data or is it anecdotal?
No. There's the data available. These are the empirical data which are available with the UN agencies.
Peer-reviewed?
Yeah.
Not urban legends?
No. The number could be much more. It speaks out a trend that there is some sort of parallel between the adult unemployment, adult's poverty, and child labor. And that's why I have been advocating that child labor and poverty are the cause and consequences of each other. We have to completely abolish child labor so that we can find more places of jobs for adult people. And most of the adults are the very parents of these children. They can find jobs in place of their own children.
But do you think you have also increased competitive challenges for Indian industry, which in any case finds it difficult to compete globally?
It's good if you are competing for good. That's great.
No, but you've raised the bar for them to make it tougher for them. Say compared to China, because you can't do very much in China.
We do in China. Whenever a single incident of China come, we expose it.
No, but who will find an incident in China? You can't even travel
freely
in China.
I traveled in China.
You can't travel freely in China.
I can't freely, that's true. But the problem is really serious here, because if you look at other data, like the number of children in schools and attending the schools, it could not be 100% fake data from China. So if almost every child is in schools, cannot be trapped into slavery, cannot be easily trafficked like that. But definitely there are child laborers and child trafficking and child slavery and all kind of issues related to children in China. But the volume is something which we don't know, but it is not so big. I can say with the full authority.